All right, we'll go ahead and start by talking about the take home. So a little late getting the take home ready for everyone because I was busy reporting academic integrity violations to Chegg again, which means somebody from last year that thought they got away with posting stuff to Chegg is going to get retroactively failed, even if they've already transferred schools, which means it'll show up on your transcripts two places. So first and foremost, don't post to Chegg or any of those sites like that. I know Chegg's not the only one. It's just the biggest one. Don't post it to the chemistry homework subreddit. Don't post it to anything. If you have to type in the questions and hit send, you shouldn't be doing it, right? I know I might seem out of touch, older, maybe I don't know everything. Everything that's going on cheating wise. I know a lot of it though. So please don't make me work. Don't take a zero on the take home instead of trying to cheat on it. Frankly, it will be better for your grade. Because if I have to go to the trouble to from a year ago, it's going to be if you just turned in nothing for the take home, you will get a better grade in this class. Then if I have to go in and get all the information from Chegg and build the case and go through all that trouble. And it's not fair to the rest of the people in the class. As you can tell, I'm rather fired up about this right now. Nobody in this class would do that. I know that, especially not after you're sitting here listening and paying attention to this rant. Just please don't. I have enough on my plate. You have enough on your plate. You don't want to repeat the course just because you didn't want to take a zero on the take home. It's 50 out of your 250 points in the exam section. You can still easily pass, even get a B with a zero for your take home test. And nobody should get a zero. The first part of pretty much all of these questions is pretty easily doable. You might need to review some things, but you can get at least half credit without even hitting any of the tricky questions, just like the ICAs, right? So don't do that.
So like, you could go on Khan Academy or something just to like look up.
Khan Academy is fine.
Yeah, like how they do so, but we can't post a specific right. question. Right,
yes. That's really where, so it's open textbook, open note. You can work in groups with people in this class. Where I draw the line is getting help from someone who's already passed the class, talking to tutors, posting specific questions online. If you can't find the answer, or you want feedback from some online resource, you could write, you can ask things like, am I doing this right for a similar question? But nothing for these specific questions goes online, okay? And as far as the rest of the...
What if it's something stupid, like, what's the point of this?
That's...
Google, you know what I mean?
So finding formulas is, yeah, that's fine. It's these specific questions, anything that's specific to these questions, any of the specific numbers that I give you in here, those are not specify a density, you'll get a different answer than people that have this test. And if you do post things, I have lots of ways to know, not just if one of my questions shows up online, but who submitted it. Okay, so just avoid that. Right. Don't ask the tutors for help just because I don't want them to have to draw the line. You're allowed to ask me for help and I'll probably, I'd at least point you in the right direction. Worst case scenario, I'll say, I'm not going to tell you that right now. Or go home and think about that again, something like that. But I don't want to put the tutors in a position where they have to judge. How much help is too help? That's not fair to them. Tutors are fair game for the practice test. In the ICAs, anything like that, but not for the take home final. Okay. Yes. Online. Don't need we're in the afternoon. I think everybody will be okay for this class because we're supposed to stop mostly by Wednesday morning, which gives us 24 hours for roads to get cleared before anybody needs to be here for this test. Those of you who are trying to take the test on Wednesday, we might have to play it by new. If you get sick or something like that, we might have to adjust and you might have to take a slightly different version of the test. I'll make it clear that it's not in your best interest to be sick and need to the test remotely. It's going to be a slightly different test and it's going to be a little bit harder being up sick. So we'll make exceptions. We'll figure out something that works. People, if anybody is sick and can't make it, but don't think that you're going to get to have it be an open book test just because you're this test is not necessarily the best indicator of the penalizing people just for being sick. I don't want to do that, but I also don't want it to seem like it's an advantage to call in sick in the next week. Fair enough? All right. Any questions about scheduling stuff last? All right. Let's talk. We talked about PV equals NRT, the ideal gas law. We talked about where those zones solve that more complicated version of the ideal gas law, but not for A or B. So it's not that bad. And these slides, if you're following along on the slides, these are the same slides from the other day. I'm just going to get to the stuff we did not finish. Just one more. Oh, Vanderwaals was after all this. So if we want to do a practice for Vanderwaals equations, again, you have to be given A and B. And it means some of your variables are going to show up in more than one place, especially moles is really difficult to solve for. B is still okay to solve for because it's not as easy as normal, but at least with volume, you won't wind up with any adding or subtracting once you simplify because you don't have a subtraction. I guess you do have a subtraction with B as part of it. Moles is the hardest to solve for though. If we want to calculate the pressure though, if we have 1 mole of water in a specific volume and a temperature, the other two pieces we need to use this equation are on this table. So basically you have to have a different you have to have a different A and B for every different gas, because every gas is a different interaction. The interactions between the gas molecules will be slightly different depending on what it is. And the ones where you really want to pay attention to it. So A, let me go back to the equation here. A has to do with this term over here, right? And this moles over volume squared is basically taking into account how likely it is that two gas molecules run into each other. So this A term basically has to do with, do the gas molecules have any interactions with each other? Are they likely to stick together or do they just bounce off of each other like ping pong balls? B is the one that takes into account how big each individual gas molecule is. So B has nothing to do with whether or not gas molecules are attracted, just how large they are. And the units on A and B sort of reflect that. So all the noble gases are going to have their A terms are going to be bigger as you get to bigger noble gases, because basically the more energy levels we have that have electrons in them, the squishier the orbitals get. They're not quite as hard as when you only have a couple of energy levels. But none of them are really interact with each other that much. It just becomes, instead of being, if helium is two ball bearings bouncing off of each other, then argon might be more like two tennis balls bouncing off of each other. They'll still bounce off, but it's a little bit softer, a little bit more give, a little more interaction. Versus xenon might be like, I don't know, two water balloons bouncing off of each other, right? They're gonna interact in a very different way based on how many energy levels you have. And again, you don't have to memorize these or even those trends. I'm just explaining what A is and why we have to look it up. And B is in units of liters per mole. Is that unit actually, what does that unit mean, if anything?
How much volume mole?
How much volume a mole of that gas is, right? If you took that gas and you condensed it all the way to being a solid with no empty space in it, how much space would a mole take up? And helium, a mole of helium would take up very little in terms of liters.
That's just taking into account the volume of the atoms.
Yeah, that's really all it is, the volume of the molecules themselves. And they're all pretty small. As expected, they get bigger as you go down the noble gases, but they're not that large. So there's not that big of a jump in terms of volume. And that's true for most of these. The larger molecules you get, the bigger that number will get. And a lot of times also the more they will interact. So you can have, these two terms though, you're gonna need to look up for every particular system. You can't just generalize. And really this doesn't take into account that if you have more than one gas present, because now all of a sudden what the gas is matters, right? For just standard ideal gas law, it didn't matter what the gas molecules were because we were assuming they didn't interact. But now all of a sudden, if you have xenon mixed with krypton, well, if a xenon bounces into a xenon, this is how they would interact. If a krypton bounces into a krypton, this is how they interact. But if a xenon bounces into a krypton, we don't have a number for that. So this is still fairly limiting, despite the fact we have a big table of data. We still can't just apply this to everything just as easily. We'd have to go find and say, okay, is there a specific, is there an A value that takes into account this particular combination of gases at a specific ratio? It starts getting, you could probably do something like take these two into a weighted average based on the mole fraction. But again, it starts getting a lot more complicated when you do that. Right. So as far as this class goes, and really the real world for the most part, unless you get to a really specific case where you really care about a ton of sig figs on your pressure, we're going to stick with PV equals NRT with a couple of exceptions, like take-home tests where I specifically say, use van der Waals equation. So if we wanted to solve this to get a number, so first off, if it's one mole of water in 22 liters at zero Celsius, at 22.4 liters, that was the volume that a mole of gas takes up at standard temperature and pressure, right? You guys remember that number? So this, if it was, if we just use PV equals NRT, and solve this problem, we would get the pressure of water was 1.00 atm. So if we plug it into the much more complicated equation and solve for P, let's see what we get. Spoiler alert, it's going to be really close to one.
We still use Kelvin, right?
We still want to use Kelvin. So pressure equals, the water is all the way down here. So A is 5.46. Sorry, pressure minus 5.46 times 1.00 moles over 22.4 liters, whole thing squared. And then I should be writing the units here. That's liters squared over moles squared times atmospheres.
The whole thing is squared, or is it just?
Sorry, just the N.
Yeah, just the N over V.
N over V is squared. But that also means it shows up in the units. So our units on 5.46 are liters squared over moles squared times ATM times 1.00 over 22.4. So basically, the liter squared and the mole squared are going to cancel out. Right, because we have leap from. So N times B. And B for water is at 0.0305. And that's liters over moles. And that's times N, which is 1.00 moles. So moles will cancel moles. All of that equals NRT. Nothing changes on the right-hand side. So that's simple enough. 1.00 moles. R is 0.08206 liters atmospheres over mole Kelvin. Dylan, do you have a question?
Yeah, I was wondering where the B went in your equation, the second one, but it's a one. So. Like the N, it's V minus NB, but N is one, so that's why you can write it.
Right. So I did. It's just really small over here.
Oh, love it.
And temperature in Kelvin, it's got to be in Kelvin. So two, and we're at zero Celsius, so 273 Kelvin. We start simplifying everything down. Get pressure plus
0.041.
And that's now in atmospheres. And our vol 22.4 minus 0.305 within sig figs is going to just be 22.4, right? Because sig figs, we're keeping our uncertainty in the tenths place and we're subtracting 0.03. So within sig figs, volume didn't change. And what is the right-hand side reduced to? Or the bottom side, the way it's drawn here. What's 273 times 0.08206?
22.4.
And that's going to be liters times atmospheres for our units, because moles cancels out moles. Kelvin cancels Kelvin. So basically, we're going to be off by 0.01. we finally solve this for pressure, we'll get pressure plus 0.011 atmospheres equals within 1.00 22.4 divided by 22.4. I can do that one in my head. So 0.99. And so in this case, all that extra work just got us 1% better. And water has a fairly high amount of interaction compared to a lot of noble gases, or even things like oxygen and nitrogen. Water interacts with itself about 5 times more. A is about 5 times larger. So generally speaking, we're going to just be able to ignore these corrections unless, how would these corrective terms get bigger? What would make them bigger? Changing what?
Higher compression, that would change the liters per mole.
So higher compression, basically, if you make volume small, then one, this term becomes a larger chunk of volume because you have a smaller number you're subtracting from. And if volume is smaller here, this whole number goes up pretty quickly. Right. So when you get to really high pressures, low volume, lots of moles, gas present, those are all things that make it so that we might have to take this equation into account. For instance, Venus has a pressure that's, I think the surface of Venus is like 10 atmospheres, and it's made out of molecules that interact with each other a lot. Made out of sulfuric acid gas molecules, and it's at a high temperature, you probably would need to actually use this form to predict things on Venus. But for our planet, current conditions, normal conditions, we don't need to use this at all.
And this will be on the take home, right? Not the time.
Not the timed part. Cool. I'm going to go backwards a little bit to talk about one more concept. Well, it's really two concepts, but one turns into the other. Kinetic gas theory is basically the idea that we can treat gas molecules as though they were just ping pong balls. They're bouncing around, they follow the regular laws of Newtonian physics. When they run into other gas molecules, they just bounce off. And it says essentially that molecules at the same temperature have the same average kinetic energy. So that means that temperature is really, a thermometer is really a speedometer for molecules. It's a way of measuring just how much energy, movement energy, those molecules have on average. Some will be going faster, some will be going slower, but the average kinetic energy is proportional to temperature. However, they're not always going to be going the same speed, because kinetic energy, if we go to a physics definition for it, kinetic energy is defined as 1/2 times the mass of an object times its velocity squared. You multiply all that together, your units get really weird, but if you're in kilograms and your velocity is in meters per second, you get kilograms times meters squared per second squared, which is an energy unit that we call a joule. So this gives us energy units when we do that, but it also means that kinetic energy is what's proportional to temperature, different gas molecules will be traveling at different speeds. Because if I say a golf ball has the same amount of energy as a bowling ball, one of them is going to be moving faster, right? A golf ball has a much slower or much lower mass. So for a golf ball to have the same amount of energy as a bowling ball, what must be true about the golf ball? If its mass is lower,
it needs a lot more speed.
It needs a lot more speed.
So can we say the temperature is equal to 1/2 mass times velocity squared?
So in order for that to be true, we need to
It's proportional.
It's proportional. And we have to say the average kinetic energy.
Oh, okay. That's the next thing.
Yeah, is proportional to mass times velocity squared.
And you said temperature was also...
Sorry, temperature is proportional to kinetic energy, which is equal to...
Okay.
And that's, and then you have to put the average velocity in there. Because really what you have, if you can picture taking 100 ping pong balls and putting them in a moving box and then shaking the box, not all the ping pong balls are going to be moving the same speed, right? They're all the same weight. They all have the same average, or that box has an average energy. But some of those ping pong balls are going to, just by luck, be moving slower than others. So you actually wind up with a graph, or when you look at, if you look at the number of molecules versus kinetic energy, you actually get something that looks vaguely bell curve shaped, called a Boltzmann distribution. It's not a true bell curve, because a true bell curve is symmetric, right? Meaning it goes off to infinity there, and it could go off to negative infinity. Why can't that be the true for gas molecules?
Negative measurement.
Can't have negative kinetic energy. If something's moving, it has positive kinetic energy.
You also can't have negative moles of something. Can't measure zero.
And we can't, it's never going to go below, but a regular bell curve also won't go less than zero here if there's an asymptote on the x-axis. But it will continue off all the way over here, whereas a Boltzmann distribution doesn't. And so what temperature is proportional to, if you take the integral of the area under the curve for this whole thing, and that's basically the percentage of the molecules that we're taking into account. If you take all the molecules and you find the average energy of all the molecules, it's going to be somewhere just left of the peak. No, just to the right of it. I say that at first and then it didn't seem right. So basically, half the molecules are moving faster than the average, half the molecules are moving slower than the average. The average, though, that point where half the molecules are to the right and half are to the left, that's what's proportional to temperature. And that's how you can have some molecules moving faster than others. This allows us to answer a couple of, some qualitative questions just by saying things like, okay, at the same temperature, which gas would be moving faster, argon or helium? You might not remember exactly where argon is, but you know it's not smaller than helium, right? Only one atom is smaller than helium. So if argon is larger than helium, which one's going faster?
Helium.
The smaller one at the same temperature, the smaller molecule has to be moving faster. And golf balls and bowling balls. And notice this doesn't mean this isn't volume. We're not talking about how large these are. This is just mass, right? So how do we determine which of these has a larger mass? Using what?
I just assume CO2 has a large mass.
And why?
It's three elements together and hydrogen's only two.
Yeah, but CH4 is five molecules. Molecular mass, right? We're not assuming that all the atoms are the same weight. So basically, as long as you have a periodic table, you can answer those questions without too much trouble, right? If it's bigger, it's going slower for the same amount of energy. We're not going to do much actually calculating these. In this version of the equation is just the way it's written to indicate that it's an average that we're talking about for the entire ensemble. Average kinetic energy is 1/2 times the number of molecules times the mass of each molecule times the velocity squared. And for whatever reason, when you talk about sets, physics uses U with a bar over it instead of a V. It's really not physics' fault, it's the mathematician's fault. They're the ones who decide, well, they can't be the same variable if it's we're talking about a set instead of just one object. So they use U with a bar over it instead of just using velocity.
Is it the average mass of all molecules?
So we're assuming that this is applying for every type of gas.
Okay.
So we're assuming all the gas molecules that we're talking about have the same mass. All CO2 molecules have the same mass.
Okay.
And then we're comparing to nitrogen. And we're assuming all of the nitrogen molecules have the same mass as each other, not assuming they have the same mass as the CO2. That's where it's different, right?
So that's the mass of the element, not the mass of your sample.
Correct. The mass of each molecule is what would go in there in AMU, which is really a really tiny number in kilograms, right? So you get a really, really small number of kilograms times however many objects you have times the velocity. So we know how many moles we have, we can turn it to atoms. And if we know what the mass is, we can actually get all the way down to what's the velocity. We just have to have some way of converting temperature into kinetic energy, but it's tricky math, but it's not that hard of a concept. So we can actually figure out what the average speed is of the nitrogen molecules flying around in here in the atmosphere, which is kind of cool. If we actually solve for average kinetic speed or average velocity, we can do it. Here's the equation to convert from kinetic energy into temperature. 3/2 times R in joule units now times temperature in Kelvin. So we can actually do this and solve for, so we get 3/2 RT equals 1/2 number of atoms or number of molecules times mass times velocity squared. You solve that for U, we wind up with, what do we get? So we need to divide by 1/2. So we get 3 RT over number of atoms and equals U squared. And actually, that's not number of atoms, that's Avogadro's number. That's just converting grams per mole into kilograms. Beside the point though, we're not gonna do any math with it, so it doesn't really matter for now. 2 canceled out with the 1/2 over there, so we just get 3. So when we actually solve for U, that just means we have to take a square root of both sides, right? So if we actually have all these terms, we can actually plug them all in and get the average velocity of a gas molecule. We just need to know what it is so we know what the mass is and what the temperature is. And the rest of this is constants. which is kind of cool. You can plug in numbers and do that. That's not all that useful though, per se. But it does allow us to talk about one, to do another way of calculating relative rates. Right? Because, so you knowing what the speed is in meters per second, what do we do with that? Well, we compare it to other gases. So this led to this idea that gases effuse. And effuse means that they move through a material or through a hole. You can picture having a balloon with a tiny microscopic hole in it. Gases are going to escape through that hole. The rate that they escape through that hole is based on how big they are. Larger gases are moving slower, which means that there's less of a chance of them making it through that gap. Even if they're way smaller than the gap itself, the fact that they're moving slower just means that they have fewer shots, right? Again, let's go back to golf balls and bowling balls. If I have 30 seconds to hit that chair with as many golf balls as possible, I could get a lot higher number than if I was rolling bowling balls, right? Every bowling ball is going to take a lot longer for me to get it moving, get it over there, right? So simply the fact that the bowling balls are bigger means I can't hit the chair as many times. The fact that molecules are bigger means that they're not going to go as fast through a material or through a hole. So the rate of one gas compared to another gas is actually, if we just look at all the other variables were constant in that last equation that I raised a second ago, right? The only thing that really changed was temperature and molecular weight. Well, if everything is at the same temperature, that cancels out too. We just get an expression that's the rate is proportional to square root of 1 over the molecular weight. So what this is doing is basically using that equation we used a second ago and canceling out all the constants and say, okay, rate of gas A compared to the rate of gas B is going to be equal to the square root of their relative molecular weights. So how do we use this? Well, it allows us to say, well, let's go back to balloons. If you fill a balloon with a mixture of helium and nitrogen, which one is moving faster, helium or nitrogen? Helium, right? Helium is a small one. If helium is moving faster, it should be escaping through the surface of the balloon faster, which is why balloons that float don't totally deflate before they start falling to the ground. Because the helium escapes a lot faster than the rest of the gases that are in there. So it stays more or less inflated, but the helium escapes faster. If we want to know how much faster, put a number to it, how many times faster, we plug in their relative molecular weight. So if you have molecular weight of helium, it's just 4.003. And our molecular weight of nitrogen, well, each nitrogen atom is 14, so 28.0. Yes. Just keep it to 3 to 4 sig figs. 28.02 grams per mole. Figuring out the relative rate is just as simple as plugging these in for A and B. You just have to keep track of what's on top and what's on bottom. Because rate A and molecular weight is on the bottom and rate A is on top, right? It's an inverse relationship with the square root involved.
right? So it's easy to confuse yourself with this. You just have to be careful though. So the rate of helium over the rate of nitrogen is equal to square root of 28.02 grams per mole over 4.003 grams per mole. Get square root of 7, right? So like 2.5, roughly.
And because our units canceled out, it's just a number.
It's just a number. It doesn't have units because we're talking about relative rates. So we can say things like, the helium is moving 2.5 times, or is diffusing 2.5 times faster than the nitrogen. And it's the same for the velocity too. It's just the velocity is not as useful. The helium atoms are moving 2.5 times faster than the nitrogen atoms are, because the nitrogen atom has a larger mass.
So there's a unit for speed in that case. So it's faster as opposed to what, miles per hour, kilometers per light?
Speed so, speed is it doesn't matter what your units are if we're talking about relative rates, right?
Okay.
So they're moving 2.5 times faster in miles per hour, and they're moving 2.5 times faster in meters per second. Just like with percentages, they just need to be the same units on top and bottom. So what's 2 more sig figs on this, just, or 3 more sig figs on this?
Just 67. That's just saying that the rate of helium is 2.5 times faster than the rate of
nitrogen. So the helium will escape 2.5 times faster from a balloon.
So that you do have to be careful with how we can use that, because if I say something like, how long does it take half of the nitrogen. If it takes the helium this long, how long does it take half of the nitrogen to escape? You kind of have to think back, okay, well, this is rates. This is a speed basically, right? And the faster it goes, which means it's gonna, the problem with that, where we had to switch that on its head earlier in the quarter, didn't we? Where, or with retention time, we were talking about chromatography. Right. If it had a higher R value, it was moving faster, which meant its retention time was shorter. Same logic here. When time gets involved, because time's on the denominator in the speed, it's faster speed means shorter time. And just to keep in mind when it comes to, if I actually put this into some sort of a word problem, which I don't think I did here. So it, at most, it might show up in the wildcard as far as actually calculating this. And you could just getting here would get you, you know, a decent chunk of the points. If that was up the wildcard question, had something to do with relative rates of gases or something like that. All right, it's more that I want you to be aware of this concept and the fact that these things, that physics still applies. We're just dealing with laws of physics and statistics at the same time, because we're dealing with a ton of them, not just 5 golf balls where we can just add up their energies separately.
And then would you in the wildfire ever ask for how much slower is something?
Yeah, if we wanted to know how much slower something was going, we could switch these and we would get 1/2.627, and that would be like, you could think of that as the nitrogen is moving at 20% the speed of helium. It's moving at 0.2, whatever that winds out to be. 1/2.627 is going to be something about a little bit under 20%.
So if we want faster, we should put the smaller on top. And if we want bigger, it's the opposite.
Right. All right. That's the last thing, and those are really just sort of special topics questions that you need to be aware of, are not going to show up on the time test. might show up in further, as you get further in your studies, those might become relevant again. When you start talking about things like did a project 1 year in Chem 103, where they measured the rate of what we have up here would affect how chickens develop, because we have fewer gas molecules, right? And the number of gas molecules is going to affect how fast they can move through the membrane. And so they used some of these same things, but you can see how if you went further in the science, and if you got into research, some of these topics might crop up in your research. They're not going to be used necessarily in everyday life, other than explaining why helium balloons don't last as long.
Next, just we're on the topic of helium. What is the chemistry of why it makes your voice higher? It's stuck in helium. What does it do?
Actually, this is related to that. It's because the helium gas molecules are moving faster. They cause your vocal cords to vibrate faster. So it's more physics, and it's a mixture of physics and biology, not even chemistry, really. Because it doesn't actually interact with your body chemically. It just, because the helium molecules are moving faster, they can cause, when they pass over your vocal cords, they make your vocal cords vibrate the same way. Has anybody ever whistled with a blade of grass? That's basically how your vocal cords work. You pass air on both sides of it and it makes them wobble back and forth. Well, if your gas molecules are moving faster because it's helium instead of nitrogen, your vocal cords vibrate back and forth faster, which results in a higher pitch because frequency goes up. It is. I can't remember why. There was something in... Anybody read Michael Crichton books? Anybody remember? There's a movie adaptation too a few years ago called The Sphere. Michael Crichton, is Crichton the same one who wrote Jurassic Park and might have even been called Pandemic. He wrote a book. No, it's Something Strain, The Andromeda Strain. A bunch of like hard sci-fi from the early 2000s, late 90s. There's a book called The Sphere, though, that takes place at the very bottom of the ocean. In basically a space station. They're talking about they couldn't use regular oxygen and nitrogen, and they made up the different react with anything. And so they all had to have like these like, robot voices that they talked with, because otherwise you couldn't understand them, because there was so much helium in the mixture of gases. I think that's actually what they do use in some of the nitrox tanks. They actually add helium, but you can't tell when you're scuba diving because nobody's talking to anybody else when you're scuba diving. I think it probably depends on where you buy them and what for. Like, you're not going to give David Attenborough the helium tank to go underwater and narrate.
That would be hilarious.
It would be. I would watch that.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right. So at this point, we can take a break. And when we come back, just go through practice problems, any of the parts of the take home or the practice test that you wanted some more clarification on. Just in case some of you don't come back, I will also say the key says that I'm not going to give you definitions, that it's going to be short answer questions or explain questions. That was from last year when it was an open book test and have to take it remotely, and then you'll get the take home version. It'll still look mostly like this, just a little bit different, but it'll still be just definitions for those of you who are just taking it in class in person. Okay. Let's take a 10-minute break. If you aren't ready for a review session, you can come back and just sit there, or I won't be offended if you don't come back from break today, since it's just review from here on out. So 10 after, I'll start talking again. Yeah. I got a couple of emails about people feeling sick. So yeah, hence why I'm being a bit more of a stickler on the mask today.
And then all three of these, the practice exam, the take home exam, and the final, everything's due next Thursday.
Correct.
And because we don't have labs or stuff, it's just going down to your office hours, or will you still be here during those times?
With the weather coming in, I hate to promise too much because if campus closes, I'm not coming in. But in theory, I'm going to try to be here for all the regular lab times as usual.
Okay.
And Monday and Tuesday, that's probably the most in jeopardy because I think we're still supposed to get like 18 inches on Monday.
Oh, no.
So if you have finals on Tuesday scheduled, start thinking about how you're going to get here or ask your teacher what they're going to do.
I had a teacher a few years ago. It snowed too much. Nobody could come in, so she just had whatever grade you had in the class with the grade in the final.
And yeah, it's changes. Teacher to teacher, but.
Thursday, we can't come in because of weather.
So if it's to the point, actually, since you have one grade in the test category already, that because I grade things so differently based on whether they're a test or whether that's I would consider that for this class because you've taken a midterm. But I also don't want to, if there's people that are right on the bubble and are counting on this to make their grade go up, I don't want to preemptively do that either.
When's that snow supposed to start? Later on Sunday?
Saturday night.
Oh, shit.
Oh, no. Is it Dana or when you're doing a study thing? Yeah, because I know you've got, because we don't have class, so we're meeting regular times and cranking.
Next Tuesday?
Yeah,
Monday. Oh, shit, it's gone up. So 25 inches on Monday?
Oh my God, this is like
shit. Oh, no. Oh, no. Are you going to be our weatherman now?
If you see here, we got a high pressure system. 9 inches, 25 inches, 9 inches, 4.5 inches, and then it tapers off. So Thursday should be okay for driving, I would think, at least compared to earlier in the week. But you have finals Monday and Tuesday. That's looking a little bit tight.
Oh,
318-7725. And Danny, are you still down for next week?
What?
Are you still down to come in next week? Even to,
well, I have to. Our final for math is worth so much.
Yeah.
I have to be here.
Would you come here on Tuesday?
But I have to work. I have to work on the top of Kingsbury. Morning, again, and I'm not going to be
growing
up. I don't care.
You're still free for like Tuesday and whatnot?
Yeah, I have to work Wednesday evening, but Tuesday, I don't know. Hell
yes. We'll figure something out.
I definitely.
And then, oh, Sean, I meant to ask you for definitions. Is the entire quarter fair game, or is it just going to be terms that we've learned since the midterm?
It'll be focused mostly on stuff since the midterm. Okay. It is still the final, though, so like I'm leaving open the possibility of asking like what's an orbital again,
right?
Since I always get good answers for that.
I also needed to ask you about my couple missing assignments in my grade book. I don't know.
I wanted to have everything regraded or fully graded and caught up. So if it shows up as a zero, then that means that I put it in, that I graded that assignment and I don't have it from you. If it's just a blank or says missing or has hyphens, then that means that I just haven't filled anything in for it yet. Again, that's... Today and yesterday were going to be my big grading days, and then I had things come up where that didn't materialize. So I'll work on that. I have time tomorrow. No, I still have all those assignments. They're sitting on my desk. If you do see a zero show up and you're pretty sure you turned that assignment in, let me know and, you know, double check it's not in your backpack still, but let me know and I can make sure it's not stuck to somebody else's.
Yep.
And if, you know, you're pretty sure you turned it in and neither of us can find it, then we'll deal with that when we get there. That hasn't happened that often.
Yeah. It's just the first missing assignment was the practice exam from the midterm. It's kind of far off, so I'm just wondering if you had.
It's taken a lot more time than I expected to move everything back from being online because I have to redo all the assignments again.
Hey, Sean, from molecular geometry, what goes in the center again? If it's three different
atoms? Whatever has the lowest electronegativity or the most vacancy. It's like hydrogen has a low electronegativity, but it's never going to go in the middle because it can only make one bond.
And the electronegativity that's
is higher electronegative. So carbon has a lower electronegativity than nitrogen.
But it's nitrogen, carbon. So it just ends in the middle, C's on top.
So lowest electronegativity goes in the middle. So carbon goes in the middle.
The lowest goes in the middle. Okay.
Right, because remember electronegativity is tied to who, whether or not it likes to share.
Kind of, it's fuzzy. But...
So the ones that are worst at sharing aren't going to go in the middle.
Yeah, I burned right through the Cable's Creek, which is along the cross country center.
All right, who wants to talk about what? Anybody have anything in the practice tent cross in particular that they were struggling with? So I try to give it to you at least a couple days in advance.
I can't remember what a metal is.
That's easy.
As far as answering a question, it's not wrong to just say a metal is anything to the left of the stair step line.
Oh, cool.
Um,
or you a better answer, you get at least 1.5 out of the 2 points just saying anything left of the stair step line. If you said the better answer would be anything that becomes more stable by giving up electrons.
So if I said made a cation,
made a cation, that would count for full credit too, right?
So not a non-metal, would be half a point?
Yeah, somewhere in there.
Let's go. What?
Something that doesn't make covalent bonds. Right. Yeah, that gets a little bit easy, but I mean, I really should grade the vocab at the end so I can use it to sort of curb the test if everybody's done poorly on the rest of it. But I usually grade it first in the average. And if you leave something blank, I have to give you 0 out of 2 for it. But if you can show me just anything that shows you even remember what chapter that term was from, do with this. I don't remember. What pressure is, but I know it has something to do with gas. It's no reason to get really anything less than like a 5, really, because you're going to know some of them, or at least be close to the full credit answer.
It's frustrating when you can take whatever the term is and like use it to solve a problem, but then to define it.
And that's why I asked this a little bit, because I don't want to just know if you can do the math. I want to know that you understand why you're doing the math. Or electrons that are in two valences at the same time. At the same time, right? That's what covalent means.
Could we just like go through one of these molecular geometry hybridization polar things?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah.
And out of curiosity, I want to see what I did for the if I filled in.
Oh, that's molecular geometry.
Oh, right. You just have to name it. You don't have to draw it.
You don't have to name. Yeah, you don't have to draw it.
Or you don't have to name it.
Yeah, you can pick whichever one makes the most sense to you that you think you could do the best in a time situation. I can't see that top. I want that back. There we go. All right, so. I didn't mean to ask you one that lines up with 7 electron groups, but I did on accident. XeF4 would be a better one that's on your list. So we'll work through it as though it's XeF4. If you did it as X6, you wind up with 7 electron groups, which xenon can do because it's past the third row of the periodic table. But that's not on our list of common molecular geometries to have 7 electron groups. That was one that was on that Vesper lab that we did. That was the challenge question, was what happens if there's 7 electron groups and you had to work out what the geometry would look like. You guys remember doing that? It's possible. Xenon hexafluoride does exist. It's not as common though. So we'll, you know, stick to things. When I actually write the test, I'll make sure I stick to things that are on your list of geometries. So it's, you don't need to show the Lewis dot structure to get credit, but to figure out how many electron domains you have, you probably want to. And so wind up with something looks like this initially, and 4 fluorine, 7 electrons, each, that's 28, plus another 8 from the xenon, total of 36 electrons. And I just used 8 of them. So now we're sitting at 28 electrons left. Each of the fluorines still needs another 6, right? Each of the fluorines still needs another 6, filling up all the fluorine valences, uses 24. Of our 28 electrons we have left. Wow, pretty dyslexic today. But so now we're not down to 28, now we're down to 4 electrons left. They have to go somewhere.
they can't go on the fluorine because the fluorine's in the second row of the periodic table. When you hit things that are in the second row of the periodic table, they can never have more than 8 electrons, period. Anything in the third row or lower, though, can go, it wants at least 8 electrons to be stable, but it can go above that if we have 4 electrons left and they have to go somewhere. And so our last two pairs of electrons are going to go on the xenon.
Is that the molecular or is that the dot structure?
That's the dot structure. Now we look at that and say, okay, well, how many things, how many electron domains are there around, how many things are taking up space around the xenon?
So
6, right? The 2 lone pairs plus the 4 bonds. So if we have 6 electron groups, that gives us, if you check that table, if you have it memorized, that gives us an octahedral electron geometry, which if we were drawing it, we would draw it like, that's the one that looks like a square with something sticking up, something sticking down, looks like XYZ coordinates. So chlorine. And so, and remember that if you're doing this from memory and you don't have your chart in front of you, as long as you know that the general shape of an octahedral electron geometry looks like this, when you're plugging in the electrons, just remember that the electrons are going to try and be as far away from each other as possible. Right, because they're bigger than the bonds. They take up more space than the bonds do. So they're going to be on opposite sides.
You have to label the angles.
If you're drawing it, that would be a good idea to make sure that you get it right. And that you're not relying on your artistic abilities. If you trust your artistic abilities, just make sure I can tell that everything is close. That and if you're using the right conventions and drawing it in just generally the same shape as normal, I know what I'm
looking at. It would all be 93, right?
Correct.
And for those of us that draw it, I can't really remember the difference, but for the molecular, do you leave the lone pairs in or do you take them away?
So for the molecular is different because you can't see the lone pairs. So our molecular geometry is square planar. And if you can't remember that, you draw it like that. And especially if you can remember at least that they're 90 degrees from each other. People that struggle with remembering in 3D and knowing some of the angles. So you can at least keep track of the geometry and label the angles, then get at least most of your points as long as you're close. And if it's one of those ones where it says like less than 90 because things are pushed closer than they're supposed to be, I'm not going to mark you down if you just wrote those.
Credit if we're drawing, you can just leave it like that. Do we have to label?
Again, as long as it's drawn like this away correctly in the standard way, then that's fine. If you drew this on its side, if you were careful about it, you could still get full credit. And if you labeled the angles, you could get full credit for it. But it gets a little bit harder for me to tell what you're trying to draw if it's not drawn in the standard way. And this isn't an art class. So. Frankly, but at this point, at the very least, I would hope that you have the names for the electron geometries down. There's only 4 of them. And one of them is linear, right? So those would be a good one, because we're going to, especially if you go on in chemistry, you're taking OCHEM next year, then we use the term tetrahedral trigonal planar all the time to discuss the shapes and how these things look like. So it's not a bad idea to at least have those ones down. But again, I'm not going to force you to memorize things. I also say things like that, but I also have a good memory. So I'm also not trying to try and impart my biases on you. just because I have a good memory. I'm not going to assume that all of you do. So if we know the square planar, hybridization is tied to what? Close, yeah. And so a basic number of electron domains, basically electron geometry, is always going to have a one-to-one connection with hybridization, meaning that there's no wiggle room. If it's octahedral electron geometry, it will always be the same hybridization. But if you don't remember what those are, all you do to figure out the hybridization is you start at the lowest energy orbital type, and you start mixing in pieces until you get to a total of six pieces. So what's the lowest energy type of orbital? An S orbital. And how many pieces does an S orbital have? You can fit two electrons, but it's one shape, right? A spin up and a spin down. So one house with two people in it. One room with two people.
Wait, what question did you just ask?
I said, how many pieces does an S orbital have?
And we decided on two?
I didn't decide on two.
We tried to decide on
two. Yes.
It's two, though?
So it's basically what I'm asking about is, remember these,
yeah,
these charts?
Yeah.
How many lines?
Oh.
One.
One. It can fit two electrons, one spin up and one spin down, but there's only one line.
Okay.
Yeah.
You're going to need one line for every electron domain that we have. So what's the next level after P? As I said, as I wrote the answer. And that has five pieces total, right? We need a total of six pieces mixed together to make this shape and fit all these electrons. So we just start at the bottom and we start adding pieces until we get to a total of six pieces. There's only one S that we can use, so then we start using P.
Well, you said by pieces, does that mean a full line, or does it matter if it has half of a, like, if it only has one roommate in the room, does that count?
We're not filling this in at all. We're just saying these are the raw pieces that we can, where we're going to put the electrons. We need to mix them together in order to make a total of six electron groups.
So you only need six of those? So you'd have two new ones?
Correct. So one part S, then we have three P pieces we can add, but we still need another two more pieces, right? That's your hybridization.
That's how you write it? That's the answer? That's done?
That's done.
Okay. I can do that.
So if your electron geometry is tetrahedral, that's four electron groups, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which means you just stop here, sp3. If it's trigonal bipyramidal, that means five electron groups, sp3d. D1, I'm not going to mark you down, but you don't need to write the one. Right? And you could keep going. The one that, as it's originally written, it had seven electron groups, right? So what would the hybridization look like?
SP3D5.
Okay, one part S. I mean, a total of seven.
It's because it's the electron, whatever geometry, right? Not the molecular.
It's the electron geometry. Those lone pairs don't have bonds, but they still have hybridization because they need to be moved away from everything else. So because they still take up space, they still count towards our hybridization. So it's not the molecular geometry that determines the hybridization, it's the electron geometry.
So those little lines are electron domains, or are they orbitals, or what are they?
So those are the orbitals. And then the way hybridization works, it's basically, if we're talking about carbon, carbon has, it's the second energy level, so you have a 2s and a 2p. And initially, it looks like this, when it's an atom. However,
covalent bonds can only form when you have one, when you have a half filled orbital. So this would say that carbon can only make two bonds because it only actually has two of its orbitals that are halfway filled. And it says that those two orbitals should be 90 degrees to each other. And so none of that agreed with what they saw. They knew carbon could make four bonds.
So one of the electrons from 2s goes up there.
Basically, you take this whole thing and you average out all of the orbitals so that they're all the same energy. They're no longer in S orbital and 3Bs. You wind up with four that are sort of halfway. When you put the electrons in, the way that they're arranged and the way that the waves cancel out and add together, it automatically forms a tetrahedral shape. So the tetrahedral electron geometry is a result of the fact that it's more stable to make four bonds because then carbon can fill its valence. Versus here, if you only make two bonds and then it still doesn't have a full valence. Right? So when you mix all these together,
so what would the hybridization
correct.
Okay.
All of the bonding orbitals here, all the orbitals and the lone pairs are all sp3b2.
Because xenon can have 12 electrons.
And mix those in order to be able to accommodate all the electrons that it has.
And then the electron domains are what's around the xenon. So the number of electrons has to equal the number of
why it keeps doing this. He was not doing this this morning. Exactly.
So how would you draw that for the molecular component?
That looks pretty good to me.
So you left the dots on that.
Geometry of the central atom.
Oh.
And how many electron domains does it have?
There's an electron domain on there, you
would
leave it off, but it doesn't matter.
Right. If there's no lone two domains, right? So that's three pairs of electrons, but they're all in the same physical space. So they only count as one electron domain.
Does that make that linear?
So geometry. And the 180, if you're trying to draw it, you draw it like this, and then probably since that seems too simple. You could add that on there. There's only two electron domains here. Pi bonds, double and triple bonds, only count as one orbital, one hybridized orbital. So it would just be SP. We need one part S and one part P. The other two pieces of the P orbital have to stay in the same shape as a regular P orbital in order to make those pi bonds that are kind of around the middle. You guys remember talking about that? Whether or not you remembered it in terms of why it matters for hybridization, it's beside the point. But the fact is that if you have two electron groups, only two of those bonds are actually taking up hybridized orbitals. So our hybridization would just be SP, one part S, one part P.
And then for polarity, we're answering the two questions, right?
Which are?
Asymmetry.
And?
Polar?
Polar bonds. If you say yes to both of those, it's a polar molecule. If you don't have polar bonds, you can't have a polar molecule. Polar bonds means that you have bonds where one side of the bond has more electron density than the other, or that one atom is more electronegative than the other. And the asymmetry means that you can't have polar bonds that are totally in exactly opposite directions. If they do, they're going to cancel each other out. Remember our analogy of football teams playing tug of war? If it's two teams of the exact same strength, pulling in exact opposite directions, nothing happens, right? But you put a peewee football team on one side and an NFL team on the other, you have net motion, right? That's the asymmetry piece.
And then for the polar bonds, it's like, oh, what's the negative it is, right?
Correct, and that's on your equation sheet. There's that table of electronegativities. And remember that carbon and hydrogen is sort of your dividing line. Carbon to hydrogen is non-polar. Anything that's a larger difference than carbon to hydrogen is polar. So let's go back to xenon tetrafluoride. And everything's 90 degrees from each other, right? Does it have polar bonds? Who has their equation sheet out? What's the polarity? Is xenon's not on there?
Yeah, it doesn't have xenon.
Okay, then I would have to give you that or correct that. If that happened on the test, just let me know, remind me, and I'll be like, oh, here's some electronegativity for xenon. Use this.
It may or may not be different, but the pole is the same in all directions, so
right,
non-polar.
And we don't really need that to answer this question, because whether or not this bond is polar, it doesn't have asymmetry. Every fluorine, let's say that they're polar bonds. The fluorine's more electronegative than everything else, so probably it's a polar bond. Fluorine, this fluorine is an NFL team pulling this way, and exactly 180 degrees from that is an NFL team pulling the other way. And then the same thing in this dimension. And the two lone pairs aren't pulling at all, but they're also not opposite of anything, right? But each other. So this is still has symmetry. So if it's symmetrical, it's non-polar.
So it has to be asymmetrical and have polar bonds.
Yes, you have to be able to say yes to both of these. So the way I would show my work on these, I would just write these two questions in each of them, and then say, and if you answer yes to both of them, you say yes, polar molecule. If you said no to either of them, you say no, non-polar.
So if something just has a single lone pair, we can automatically assume that it's asymmetric. So
yes. Yes, if you have a single lone pair, it's always going to be asymmetric. I hate saying always. Yeah,
have to be if it's a lone pair. That's an always.
Good.
Yeah, I think we can say that. How about hydrocyanic acid? So CN is cyanide, right? With a negative one charge, so you add an H to it, it becomes cyanic acid, hydrocyanic acid. Does it have polar bonds? Well, carbon to hydrogen, I told you to use your definition of non-polar, so that doesn't count. But is carbon to nitrogen polar?
Yes. Yes. Towards the nitrogen.
So, yeah, there's a partial negative over here and a partial positive on the other side of the molecule, on the other side of that bond.
And same sort of field between the hydrogen and carbon.
And even if we don't consider this a polar bond, if we don't consider a polar bond, we just kind of ignore this part of it because we say that there's no net pull one way or the other. But we do have a polar bond. Do we have asymmetry?
No.
Why not?
Because it's sharing way more with the nitrogen.
It's sharing way more with the nitrogen. Is there anything balancing that out on the other side? So we do have asymmetry. It is not symmetric, is what I think you meant to say.
So it's not symmetrical, even though like the shape of it is symmetrical.
It's linear.
But
because there's
exactly
different amount of pull towards the different things.
Because the hydrogen doesn't pull electrons with the same strength that the nitrogen does.
The carbon.
And then how did you come up with those little partial negative and positives? Are we like using these numbers here on the chart?
Yes, whatever is most electronegative is going to have a partial negative. And we write that as a lowercase delta, but not that one because that's the math people use that one. So one side of the molecule, in order for it to be polar, this has to be true. There has to be one side of the molecule that's partially negative and another side that's partially positive.
So when you're looking at this chart and you're saying carbon, hydrogen,
right. The difference between them is about 0.38, right?
0.35 on our test.
0.35
so
on that.
Like, we're subtracting?
We're just subtracting what's on either side of the bond. So carbon and hydrogen is only 0.35. We call that, carbon is more electronegative than hydrogen, but barely. And so we wouldn't consider that a polar bond. Carbon to nitrogen, though, is a bigger difference, more around 0.5, right?
Are you always subtracting the things over here from over here? Or is it just whatever number's bigger?
Yeah. Whatever has the higher electronegativity is pulling the electrons towards itself. So it doesn't really matter. I don't really want to say take the middle one and subtract the outside because it's really about what is the difference. That it can go either direction. Just know that whoever has the higher electronegativity has the extra electron density.
I was trying to find in my notes and I couldn't, but I do remember something that if it was above 0.35, it meant something. If it was below 0.35, what is that again?
So the 0.35 is carbon to hydrogen, right?
So
if a difference is less than 0.35, a smaller difference than carbon to hydrogen, it's a non-polar bond. Basically, we can treat it like the electrons are shared more or less evenly.
Less than 0.35 is non-polar?
Correct. And if it's bigger difference, that means you've got a bully and a little kid. It
means it's polar.
Okay, and it's polar.
So our baseline for non-polar is a carbon hydrogen.
Yes.
Because nothing's going to be exactly 0.35.
Right. And depending on what book you use, sometimes they'll put 0.4 to it, but also a lot of times their electronegativity values only go to the tenth place. And so 0.35 is really 0.4. So I just always remember that's our dividing line.
It doesn't matter how many of the element that we have. So the fact that there's six fluorines, that doesn't matter. We only take one minus the xenon or whatever.
Well, it means each bond is going to have that same difference.
Okay.
So each of these bonds has a difference of 0.8. Each of these bonds has a difference of 0.8, which means each of these bonds is a polar bond, but because they're pulling in exactly opposing directions, the overall charge is not spread out the same way. You don't have a positive side of the molecule and a negative side of the molecule. It's symmetrical.
Wait, so polar is a smaller number?
Polar is a larger difference. It's been a while since we went over that, and we did that pretty quickly after we finished the midterm, and then we left for stoichiometry land and haven't been back since. So, All right, any other specific questions? We have 10 minutes still scheduled here. I do have office hours till 4:30. We'll move out of this room and move down to, you guys welcome to hang out in lab, although it's kind of busy moving stuff around, or outside in front of the bio lab and keep asking questions as they come up. But before we end here, does anybody have anything specific?
When balancing, do you have to break up like the phosphate group? Like when you in the back, you can keep it as a unit?
Yeah, as long as it's the same on both sides. Like here we have sulfate on one side and sulfate on the other side. You can balance that just as sulfates. If you only have to break it up into sulfurs and oxygens, if the sulfate is being broken up into something else.
Okay,
so if it was sulfate goes to sulfur dioxide and, I don't know, peroxide molecule, that's not really a reaction that we would expect to happen very much. But in theory, the fact that it's not sulfate anymore means we can't balance to sulfate. We have to break it into sulfurs and oxygens now. But yes, as long as everything stays, all your polyatomics stay stuck together the same way as normal, you can just count polyatomics, this many nitrates, that many nitrates.
Cool. Even out if you distribute anyways too, right?
And it should even out if you distribute anyway. You're just, every sulfate has one sulfur and four oxygens, right?
Mm-hmm.
So even if you broke it up, if your sulfates are balanced, your oxygens and sulfurs are as well. Unless you have oxygen and sulfur in something else over here.
When is the date going to be?
Thursday. Everything's due Thursday, week from today. So final push. You're almost there. And then you get to start it again. If you're taking 102. But 102 is actually, it's still a lot of work, but it's, but I think that the material is more fun because it's further past just high school chemistry. This, all of this is not that different than high school chemistry yet, but 102 is where you start seeing some differences and things start getting really cool. But then again, I could just be thinking that because I teach 101 every year for the last 5 years and haven't taught 102 in a while.
Actually, I have a question just to make sure that the equation is right for number 10, the fun one.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're telling us that reaction is filled with moles of oxygen, then you have the ethanol and C4. Are we having oxygen on the left side of that little arrow thingy? So you have a regular oxygen plus C2H6O plus C4H10 equals?
No. This is like 2E from the last ICA.
It's two,
to some extent.
Yeah. It's two different reactions.
It's two different reactions.
Both of them get added to O2 to create C2.
Right.
They're O2s, right?
They're both plus O2 goes to CO2 and water. They're both combustions. You just have to write it as two reactions in a row.
And then at the end, are we supposed to have to figure out, so whatever's left from the beginning, which is, ends up only being like one thing, right? I don't know.
What are you anyway. What are you talking about? You can say which one you're.
So the first reaction was one with butane. And then that uses up all of butane.
Correct.
And then you have water, and then it's not water. O2 gas is limiting reaction.
Depending on, it's pretty close. So depending on how, if you did your subtraction, your and your sig figs, it might be. I saw somebody else had a different answer, but it's pretty close to. Do you still add that? That the.
Is it like a legit way to figure out what the limiting reactant is to just like multiply it by however many? Like once you have it in moles, to multiply it by.
It's a little bit blurry. So when I did this math, assuming I didn't change any numbers. I use the ice table to keep track of everything. I wound up with, for the second reaction, oxygen is the limiting reactant. Assuming I didn't change any numbers, but it wound up being pretty close because I said, okay, if I have 0.6513 moles of ethanol and every mole of ethanol burns 3 moles of oxygen, and I have 1.41 moles of oxygen, that I'm running out of oxygen. Like you can, and then, so then if I know oxygen is running out, I can set this equal to 0, solve for Y, plug in all the rest of these and say, okay, I have 0.18 moles of ethanol left, 2.63 moles of CO2, 3.5 moles of water, and so on. I remembered that.
Yeah.
That's why I hedged when she said oxygen runs out first, but she and I agree. So I'm double check your algebra on there. It could just be, it could be an issue with balancing. Make sure it's balanced the same way. But I seem to remember you had a 2-to-1 ratio for ethanol to oxygen, right?
Ethanol to oxygen, I got 2 to 13.
That's the top one for butane and oxygen. Down below on the second reaction, whatever.
C2H6O, that's
ethanol. Yeah.
1 to 2 for
oxygen. So I think that might be.
I got 1 to 3.
I got 3. Yeah. And that'll throw off your answers. And that's why. Yeah. And when we did it yesterday, I didn't actually stop to balance it. And so I just put a 2 there.
So at the end of this, you end up with ethanol, water, and CO2, right?
Correct.
And you have to know the amounts of all those. And then the mole fraction is just like doing a percent.
What is
divided
that
by this
fraction?
Number of moles.
So mole fraction is percent by mole, except you know you don't need to multiply by 100. So you know how many moles of butane of ethanol you have left. That's just what moles of CO2.
So I don't need to multiply by 100. So
you just divide. I'm not going to mark you down if you multiply by 100 and write it as a percentage, but you can leave it as a decimal. It's the more correct way to do that.
Mole fraction be what? Mole total over mole carbon dioxide?
So mole fraction of CO2 is moles of CO2 divided by moles total.
Oh, that was close.
Yeah. Like I said, if you guys are used to doing percent by mass and percent by volume now, this is just percent by mole, part divided by the total.
And why don't we multiply by 100?
If I said what percentage of them were CO2 molecules, yeah, then we'd multiply by 100. Mole fraction, because mole fraction shows up as a variable in equations down the line, we don't want to multiply by 100 because we want it as the decimal.
Mole fraction, you said mole percentage.
If I said mole percentage, you would multiply by 100. All right, and again, this is a sort of a long one. It's just two stoichiometry steps in a row. You just have to keep track of how much you made in each of them. How much CO2 did you make from reaction one? How much CO2 from reaction two? How much water from one? How much water from two?
You said the butane reacts much faster than ethyl. That does not make the butane the limiting reactant, right? It just
not on
faster.
Its own. It just means that burning butane is faster than burning ethyl.
Okay.
So are we going to be able to have scratch paper?
Yeah. So some of those are, especially number 10 is a long one. 9 and 10 are the longest ones. But yeah, I will bring scratch paper. You're welcome to use lined paper if you like. You just attach it to show your work.
You're still going to do the one page per question thing.
Yeah, and I'm spacing all this out. So it'll be a bigger packet that I hand you, but you'll have a whole page for every section.
So, and then just message you on Canvas if we want to meet on non-slow days.
So I will be here for your labs in my regular office hours, assuming the call isn't open. So, like normal. Yeah.
Yeah.
I add 0.6513 moles of ethanol.
Yeah. You have 0.645 moles of ethanol. So that'd be more ethanol.
It might just be a sig fig thing. 0.645. That is a little bit further off than I would expect sig figs to be.
So is the excess there?
No, because so if you get the that's not off by that much. You have well more than, if you actually have if it's actually 0.645, tripling this is, or tripling 0.645 is still more than this.
Okay.
So you should still be, if it's a 3-to-1 ratio, you'll still be running out of oxygen.
Oh, I see.
We're just, this number is different for the two of us, and maybe that, maybe I grabbed a different. It's possible I just wrote down the number wrong.
I got down to, after the butane reaction, 1.44 moles of oxygen.
Okay, so you're close on that one within sig figs, 1.41 and 1.443. So yeah, then.
Right on, I can just jump from that number and go back to.
Yeah, the only thing that's different is that that's going to be a 3-to-1, not a 2-to-1, assuming that that that's just a sig fig difference between the two here.
Yeah. And you did do it in a different way. Keeping all the numbers and not counting everything.
Yeah.
Close enough.
Yeah, I'm just looking at. So 30, what'd you use for your molecular weight for ethanol? When you got to correct to moles from grams to moles of the C2H6. That might've been where you got mixed up, because if you used, if you mixed up CO2 is really close to it. It's 44 for CO2, and I think it's 46 for ethanol. If you plugged in the 44 on accident, that could have been why you're off by a couple percent there. But
yeah.
That and the balancing is the bigger issue. The other one is probably just sig figs.
Yeah, I'll jump back through that. My paper's already get more organized on it.
Well, yeah, it's as long as you get the right answer, just having
the right numbers.
Right, then I.